Welcome back to another episode of Practical Nutrition. I'm Cassie.
I'm Alex.
I'm Sarah.
And I'm Amanda.
And today we are going to talk about new nutrition trends for 2022. Some of these aren't new necessarily, but just kind of what is trending right now. And happy 2022. I'm going to have a hard time with that all year.
I know.
I've read 2021 like 15 times.
I know. 2022 is just a hard thing to say, but happy new year, everyone. And this is our first podcast of the year, so we are excited to have another year of awesome content and to interact with you guys. So we're going to focus on 10 things that we're seeing, and trends are really different than fads. We're not really talking about fads today because trends have a little bit more of a direction that we're going. They're a little bit longer lasting by definition than fads, which, you know, are very short-lived and maybe don't have a lot of scientific backing. So these are things that we might see more of. We might hopefully see more research on. So that's what we're going to talk today about. Not, like I said, not necessarily fads, but more trends. So we're not going to dive into a lot of research on each topic, because if we did that, we would spend the whole podcast on each one. So we don't want to keep you here for about 5 hours. So we're just going to give you the information just so you have a little bit of info if you hear about these things. And then we are going to do some podcasts on some of the stuff in the future. So if you want more information about something specific, let us know. So the first trend we're going to talk about is sustainability. So carbon neutral labeling is showing up on foods. That's going to be something new that you'll see. And so let's talk a little bit about what that means, because some people have no idea what is carbon neutral. What does that mean? Yeah. So Alex is going to get us started with that.
Yeah, and I've definitely heard more about it. It's interesting to read about it. Greenhouse gases such as carbon dioxide, nitrous oxide, and methane have the ability to trap heat in the atmosphere, which can be harmful to the environment, as we already know. The carbon footprint of a food is the total greenhouse gas emissions caused directly or indirectly by the food. This is calculated by summing the total emissions caused by every stage of the food product, so manufacturing, production, growing, processing, and the use of the food, and subtracting how the company offsets this by decreasing the emissions in-house and supporting external projects to decrease emissions. So, for example, Google isn't necessarily a food company, but they've purchased high-quality carbon offsets to reduce their carbon footprint, so then they're considered a carbon-neutral company. And then you can also invest in regenerative solutions for natural ecosystems, or helping to conserve at-risk areas, preserving trees, that kind of stuff is how you can be more carbon-neutral.
That is so interesting. And I think it's confusing because people think, how did they make this food without producing any carbon? And that's not what it means.
Yes.
It just means that they're offsetting. So it's kind of like cut down a tree, plant a tree. You know, it's that same kind of concept.
Right. Because you can't necessarily cut it out completely. Yeah. So it's offsetting it. That's right. Exactly the way to put it. There's no current entity that controls how the word sustainable is used on food labels, but there are companies that are offering certifications for products such as Climate Neutral, a nonprofit organization, so you may start seeing the certification on different products. So just be careful with marketing. The food industry can be tricky, as we've already found out. Moonshot, which is a product that nobody's really brought up to me, I'm just kind of Googling stuff, and that's a brand. They're making climate friendly crackers.
Oh, no way.
So Moonshot's one to maybe look out for. And then several companies in the UK have been certified as carbon neutral, but the first USA food company called Neutral launched last fall. You can find this brand at Whole Foods. They make carbon neutral organic milks and half and half and stuff. So
cool.
Yeah, it's interesting.
Here in Springfield, we don't have a Whole Foods, but maybe some of the local markets will get those as well. And just because something doesn't have that certification doesn't mean that they're not doing things to help the environment either, but this is just something that you'll start seeing. Here is a little bit more information about carbon footprints and food, which I found some of this really interesting. Yeah. So Sarah's going to talk about this.
Yes. So if you didn't know, the average household produces 7.5 tons of carbon dioxide equivalents per year. And food equals around 10 to 30% of this footprint, with food production being the majority of the carbon footprint, about 68%. And then transport being a smaller amount, only about 5%. And meat has a much higher carbon footprint than vegetables or grains per calorie because of the inefficient process of converting plant energy into meat energy, because animals need to eat plants to grow, and animal waste and gas production. And so, you know, I know a lot of people that have become vegetarian or vegan because of the sustainability, the carbon footprint factor of it. And this is why there is truth behind that. And eating one vegetarian meal per week is more effective at decreasing the carbon footprint than eliminating food transport for an entire year. That's wow. crazy.
I know.
That's so interesting.
I know. I found that so interesting. That was one of the most interesting statistics, because you think, oh, eat local to help, but really you have even a bigger impact with having one vegetarian
meal. Imagine if we all ate one vegetarian meal a week, and what kind of impact it would make.
And those are things, you know, that we do encourage our clients to do. Beans and legumes are vegetarian.
Meatless Mondays.
Absolutely. Yeah. So not only can you help your health, your heart health, your risk for diabetes, those things, but you can also help the environment as well. So all good things. And meat choice also makes a difference. So chicken produces 7 times less greenhouse gas emissions than beef. So this is a reason why, like, cows and beef sometimes get a bad rap beyond, you know, saturated fat content and things like that. So if you didn't know that, now you do. And meats account for 57% of food's greenhouse gas emissions, with dairy being 18%. Fish and seafood account for less than 6%, beverages 6%, eggs 3%, veggies 2.6%, fruit 1.6%, and grains 2%. The more you eat foods like vegetables, fruits, and grains instead of meats and dairy, the lower your carbon footprint will be. And if you are curious at what your own carbon footprint is, you can actually calculate that at the Environmental Protection Agency website, and we'll link that in our description box so you have that available to you.
Very cool.
I know.
That's cool. Crazy. I'm totally doing it.
Yeah.
And I think a lot of people want to do something to help the environment, you know, so this is really good. So hopefully the food industry is going to get on board as well. But something that you can do today is eat some more veggies and fruits, which is what we recommend.
Which we love.
Imagine that.
Yes. And plant-based proteins, which are really good for you. Mm-hmm. So the next trend we're going to talk about is nutrition to help you age well. So it's not just about living longer. That was a big focus. It's about living well and aging well, and Amanda is gonna talk about this.
Yes, so people are getting more interested in managing the risk factors and improving health with food, what we like to call food as medicine, because it can improve a lot of risk factors such as heart health, blood sugar, blood pressure, cognition, cancer, obesity. A popular diet trend is the MIND diet. That's an acronym, M-I-N-D. It stands for Mediterranean Dash Diet Intervention for Neurodegenerative Delay.
Glad we can say MIND instead of
In an epidemiological study in almost 1,000 people over almost 5 years, it showed adhering to the MIND diet significantly decreased cognitive decline. More controlled research is definitely needed, but these are healthy eating habits that we already recommend, so there's no need to wait and see if it helps your brain. You can implement these foods studied in the MIND diet now. They include vegetables, especially green leafy vegetables, berries, nuts, olive oil, whole grains, beans, fish, poultry over red meat most of the time, 1 glass of wine per day.
Yeah, that actually was in the study. Yep. And people who had 1 glass had less cognitive decline than people who had none. So there you go.
Okay. Yeah. So 1 glass, when we say 1 glass, we mean 5 ounces is one serving of wine.
Yes, thanks for clarifying.
Yes,
this is true.
Yeah, keep us all
honest. You're no fun, Amanda. <Just bubble. laughs>
And then lastly, adaptogens are showing up on food labels. There's more information to follow. I'm going to do a podcast on adaptogens because I find that very fascinating. But adaptogens are natural substances that are thought to help the body handle stress that typically disrupts the body processes in a healthier way, so the body can return back to its normal equilibrium.
Yes, very good. So also, more people are looking for healthy lifestyle changes over diets that may not be healthy or sustainable. And that's something I'm seeing that people that we're working with are not coming in as much anymore and saying, help me with this particular diet, which is very refreshing. So we're seeing these decreases in traditional fad diets, Atkins or really the low-carb keto types of diets are actually showing a big decrease in how many people are searching for them and looking for information about those this year. And so, you know, and people are looking more about lifestyle changes if it is a fad, which this is something I was asked about actually this week in the gym, this blue zone diet. Mm-hmm.
Have you somebody asked me about it too. I hadn't really heard about it.
Blue zone. So this is really interesting. So I thought, you know, I talk a little bit about this. You may have heard about the blue zone diet. So this was brought about by someone named Dan Buettner, who works for National Geographic, writes for them, and is a fellow for them. And he looked for 8 years just at different communities around the world to see, you know, who lived the longest and what those people did in those areas. And so people who have a very long lifespan, he considered these areas blue zones. And so that's what that means. And those areas that had remarkable longevity that he looked at were Okinawa, Japan, Sardinia, Italy, Nicoya, Costa Rica, Icaria, Greece, and Loma Linda, California. And in California, we know just as nutrition people that that is the home of a big population of the Seventh-day Adventists, mm-hmm. which is how we got a lot of research on plant-based eating and why we know that it is really healthy. So if you don't know anything about Seventh-day Adventist or Loma Linda, you should look it up online because it's really interesting. We won't go into all that today, but we'll go over a few of those things. So when they looked at those populations and thought, okay, these are the areas that people live the longest, then they looked at, okay, what are their habits? What do they do? And I found this really interesting because it is really just about a healthy lifestyle. So it's what it is. And so, but what they found, and again, this is association, not causation. So there were no, you know, controlled, we'll put this population. So there could be some other factors in there. But it is definitely something interesting and hopefully we'll look at a little bit more. There was an abundance of legumes, which are beans and peas, which is so interesting because a couple of years ago, those were on the no-no list at a lot of fad diets. These are not if you look at Whole30, and those kinds of diet plans, don't eat legumes or what they would say. So as dietitians, we find this all very interesting because we've always recommended beans and legumes because they are healthy, and the healthiest populations do eat them. So plenty of whole grains, again, another thing on all of the, you know, types of diets that are lower carb have said not to have, and that grains are unhealthy for you. And then your starchy veggies like corn, another vilified food. So sweet potatoes, you know, those kinds of things. And so just very interesting whenever you look at this and how people can be swayed by what the media and people in the media are telling them. Plenty of greens, meat about 5 times a month. Not 5 times a week, which most people do a lot more than that, which you know, that's okay. But those populations didn't eat a whole lot of meat. Fish 1 to 2 times a week, so a little bit more often. Small amounts of cheese were included in a lot of those areas. Very little, if any, processed foods in those areas, and really no processed meat. So that's your bacon. Understand. So not that you, again, can never eat those things, but it's a lot of the fad diet says that, you know, eat as much bacon as you want, but don't eat a piece of bread, you know, may or may not be the best option. So that's interesting. And again, we're not going to go into a whole lot of information about that, but really there also were things about community, making sure you have a support system, being active, decreasing stress. The Seventh-day Adventists start at Friday night as kind of their Sabbath, and they turn, there are no electronics, there is no, you are with your family.
That for myself.
And then all day Saturday until Sunday morning. They volunteer together. So it's just kind of taking it back to more of a simple time. But I do think that's, like we talked about, Meatless Mondays. That's something that maybe everyone can take home from this too, and what they're looking at is it is okay to regroup, slow down, focus on what's important, community, friends, yourself, for one day a week. You know, having none of that would be very challenging, you know, but a little bit of that might be something that we all could do better with as well. So
I just want to say about the Blue Zones is that National Geographic printed a cookbook written by that Dave something with a B, Buettner.
Yes, he has a cookbook and a book.
Yes.
Which is very popular right now. Yes. So,
the cookbook's really, it's really good.
Yeah. So, I saw that they had a cookbook. So
we can put a link in the description box.
And they also, because I went on the website for the Blue Zones, and they have an assessment tool as well. Mm-hmm. And so they ask you questions about just all the things that they found that these people had in common, which was really interesting. But then you had to give them your contact information to get your results. So I didn't do it.
And your credit card, your social security number.
I will tell you that. So I don't know. I probably should have done it just so I could have done it to tell you guys what would happen. But I just get so many emails anyways. And I, you know, so I find this interesting. But they do have an assessment tool that is free. Possibly they might contact you a bunch or try to sell you something afterwards, which whatever, that's okay. But but we'll definitely link that. So so the other trend that we're seeing, the next trend, which is very much related to Blue Zones, and something that we have always recommended, is plant-based eating. So Alex is going to talk about that.
Yeah, and flexitarian is something that is coming. It's a word that's being used a lot more, and it's really just plant-based eating with occasional meat and fish in there. So it's not your strict vegetarian or vegan, but you're a little more flexible with it. Hence, flexitarian.
Yeah, that's kind of the Blue Zone.
So I think that would be something to adapt if you don't want to be strict vegan, vegetarian. Maybe adapting more flexitarian type of eating. It's definitely becoming more mainstream. People are seeing the benefit of eating mostly plants, even if you eat some meat as well. So that's that flexitarian type of eating. Some people are more interested in health benefits, such as research-backed improvements in lifespan and overall health, if done correctly. Some people are more interested in environmental benefit due to less production of greenhouse gases, better use of land, and more sustainable practices to provide food for more people. So watching our carbon footprint and then just the benefit of plants in general and eating what's coming from the earth and all that stuff. People are getting more on board with that, which is exciting.
Yeah, that is exciting. That's great. So another trend is eating to support your immune system with COVID and all those things. Yeah. Alex is going to talk about that as well.
Yes. So with COVID hitting us hard, especially right now, people are focusing more on their immune systems, and many people have been supplementing vitamins and minerals. But people are looking for ways that they can eat to improve their immune system with whole foods, which is a good thing. There is synergy with nutrients from food that you don't find in supplements, which means that nutrients and foods work together to get an even better result than the nutrient by itself. So yes, supplements have their place, but we don't want you just taking supplements and not eating fruits, veggies. Be sure you're getting fruits, veggies, good sleep, lots of water, exercise, all the things that we've been recommending, because food does have a synergistic effect when eating it together. Nutrients that are on top of the list for helping support your immune system are found in fruits, veggies, whole grains, healthy proteins, nuts, seeds, and seafood, and include things such as vitamin A, D, C, E, B6, B12, folate, zinc, iron, copper, selenium, omega-3s. So lots of different nutrients that are going to help us with our immune system.
And I sense support. A trend in these trends.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Yeah. Lots of just more plants. Plant-based eating.
There is a trend. And they all is. Yeah. So which is, it's a good thing.
Which makes it easier, you know?
Yeah, exactly. So I love it. Next, which is another interesting thing that I saw and I'm hearing a lot about too, but are sea veggies, like seaweed, sea lettuce, sea asparagus, which I've never had. Sarah's going to talk a little bit about those.
Yeah, so I did actually Google what sea lettuce and sea asparagus looks like just to see if it looked different, and it does. And same with, people have probably either tried or seen, seaweed chips or, the like crunchy seaweed strips, mm-hmm. and they do the same with sea lettuce and sea asparagus. I don't know where you can get them from. I've never seen them in Walmart, but maybe Hy-Vee, maybe Natural Grocers here. So anyways, what they are is, you know, along with the sustainability factor that we've been talking about, is they do have less carbon footprint than land vegetables, and research shows that certain types of seaweed may actually decrease methane production from cows if added to their feed. I wonder if there's research done on cows and things.
There is. And that's, I found some, and there needs to be more done, yeah. which is what the research said, but there was the research that I found showed that certain types of seaweed mm-hmm. added, and they're still looking at, is this the best, the amounts, but it decreased it by in the 90% what? Range for methane Whoa. Production wow. and gas. Because you do wonder, because there are tons of animals that eat tons of things, mm-hmm. and humans as well, you know, but if we change what we feed cows, yep. maybe it can help. So
yeah, interesting.
How many types of seaweed are there?
A bunch, I think. Yeah, a bunch. So Jeez. It depends on where it's grown. I mean, there's all sorts of, and again, we could probably do a whole
We're
podcast on
nerds.
This.
We're such nerds. Yeah, we love
but
this.
But it's very stuff. Interesting. And there's this whole aquaculture that is, you know, and some, you know, other countries that mm-hmm. we really yeah. haven't done.
Haven't tapped into that
yeah.
much.
So, yeah. but interesting.
Yeah, and they're also more nutrient dense than other vegetables. They actually do have a little more protein, some more fiber, iodine, vitamins A, B, C, and E, and they're excellent sources of calcium and iron, along with antioxidants. And they are easier and faster to grow than land vegetables, but be aware that sea vegetables often do contain some amounts of lead, cadmium, and arsenic, which are heavy metals, and they can cause harm if consumed in large amounts. And then additionally, because they are great sources of iodine, too much iodine can also be harmful for your thyroid, and too many heavy metals can lead to cancer. So keep your intake at one serving per day. Don't just live off of seaweed and sea asparagus.
Because oftentimes it's like, oh, these are good. Well, more is better. So you do have to watch right. that. Great, you know, they do have a lot of nutrients and they're dense, but we do have to watch that. So, and, you know, Consumer Labs is a third-party testing organization that actually did a whole article on seaweed products, mm-hmm. and so there were a couple that they did show that had no very low levels of those heavy metals, and so you can subscribe to that. It's a great organization. I highly recommend it. I don't want to steal their info and tell everyone, but you could go there and find out what the report said. but that's really good, and I think worth the subscription. We look at that all the time when we're helping recommend things. So so very interesting. Mm-hmm. And also with the heavy metals, and just watch with your kids' intake as well, or younger, smaller people. So because they are at a higher risk for having negative effects for smaller amounts. Next, which I'm really excited about too, this trend is just people are wanting more quality food, Yay. Which I think mm-hmm. is very exciting. Sarah's going
to
talk about that.
Yeah, this is probably one of my favorite things mm-hmm. to talk about as a dietitian, because I feel like it's often forgotten about, because people put such an emphasis on like, get your protein in, eat your macros, this is the amount of calories you're supposed to eat. And so like fat-free cheeses and processed protein powders and, you know, all of those things that have extra stuff in there that we don't necessarily need, you know, starts to go to the top of the totem pole, and then all of those really quality foods that are more dense in calories or whatever start to get dropped off. And that's not necessarily what we want you to think of whenever you think of healthful foods. And Cassie said this, and I've said this before, but we like to look at the ingredient labels before we look at the nutrition facts labels. Obviously, we want to make sure you're getting, you know, good quality protein and the right types of fats and things like that. But we want you to have overall quality ingredients as well. And there is more interest, you know, in how food is grown, what's in it, where it's produced, and how it can improve your health. And excitingly enough, consumers are getting smarter and they're learning how to read labels and just understand, you know, food marketing in general. And due to, you know, the research negative health effects of junk foods, people are wanting to avoid or limit those more processed foods. And if you are interested in more information on the quality of food, because yeah, we could sit here and have a whole podcast on it. We actually already do have a podcast on it. It's called What's Really in the Food That You're Eating. So feel free to check that out if you want more info.
Yes. So that's good. So, and I do think, I also think we have a podcast on some of the nutrients that are helpful for your immune system and where you can find those mm-hmm. Nutrients some food too. So yeah. So so yeah, we have that. So awesome. Next is intuitive eating, and Amanda's going to talk about that.
Mm-hmm. So many people are getting tired of diets. Thankfully, it's about time, people. Strict rules and want to bring the joy back to eating. So intuitive eating is an anti-diet mentality with a focus on enjoyment of food, balancing foods that promote health with fun foods. There are no good or bad foods. All foods can fit. No cheats or yo-yo dieting, and that's something we can definitely get behind. Mm-hmm. And the intuitive eating principles, they have a bunch of books and a really expansive and complex website, so feel free to like order those books and read them or ask us about them.
Yeah, and we have intuitive eating books in our library as well that are free for people to borrow, mm-hmm. so you can always come by and check it out at the front desk as well. So we need to get the Blue Zone books to we'll add that too. So if you don't want to purchase something, you know, we always say we're nutrition nerds and we love reading and having those books. So I have all the books. so you can come, but you can come borrow them for free. Just bring them back. So next is meal prep. And I thought, that was good. We could talk about that too.
Yes. So meal prep. So if you didn't know, I manage the meal prep program. So if you want meal prep, hit me up at amanda@achievingyourbest.net. Okay, so people are wanting ways to make healthy eating work for their busy lifestyle. Many people got out of the habit of eating fast food during COVID, and they enjoyed eating at home with their family more often. So as we get back to our busy schedules, people want to keep this going, and these are some of the popular ways people are making this happen. So you can hire a chef or a meal prep service.
And it is more realistic than people realize. Because I think people often think, oh, that is not in my budget to have a chef, you know. Yes. But we do. We definitely make it in a way that people can afford it.
So yeah, we're not here to steal your money.
So
we want to provide quality services.
Yes. And Amanda can send a quote too if you're just interested. She can kind of let you know how much you'd be looking at.
Exactly. It's personalized for your nutrition needs by a dietitian, and it is very realistic. And a lot of people enjoy it. So hiring a chef or meal prep service. Okay, making time to plan or using easy, quick, healthy foods. So sitting down like once a week or a couple times a week and making a plan for what you need to pick up at the grocery store or order on your online grocery delivery service. Online shopping is more popular than ever to help us save time, and meal kits to help people eat at home as well.
Yeah, that's all good. And it's always funny to see. I love going to the grocery store after the new year to see, you know, what they have out there. And it's always like protein bars and protein shakes. Yeah. But then I also saw at Hy-Vee, I'll give a shout out to them. They had a ton of pre-cut vegetable kits and pre-cut fruit kits, and so they more than usual, so they were really trying to help people, so you can easily do those kinds of things as well, just to help with your prep time, because sometimes that is what people need. So thank you, Amanda. Also local, seasonal, and regional foods.
Yes, people are embracing different cultures and flavors from specific regions and cooking more diverse and flavorful foods. This is something fun to like get into with your family if you start cooking more at home, is like experimenting with different seasonings, looking up different cultural foods. Something I've been into lately is like curry dishes, which is like an Indian trend. So, and eating local and supporting small businesses continues to be important to a lot of people, and we have many like locally sourced food restaurants like Derby Deli, Culture Counter. There's a lot around Springfield.
Yes.
People in Springfield really value local producers. And then also buying and eating produce that's in season saves money, and the produce will taste better.
Yes,
for sure.
It does, definitely. So people are just starting to notice those things, and I think that's good. And I can taste a huge difference in like the box Turtle Farm lettuces versus the other lettuces that you might get. And those are local, and you can find those at Mama Jean's. So maybe you start noticing that and seeing how much better the food tastes. And then you're supporting small farms and things that maybe don't have as big of an environmental impact as well, as a nice little addition. So, so next, the next trend is changing your negative COVID-related habits and maintaining positive ones. And this is actually our last one. So, but in, you know, a lot of people created habits. We've seen this actually in research during COVID, whenever we had lockdown. So, you know, and a lot of at this point, you know, what we talk to people all day long about habits and healthy habits, and I think a lot of people have kind of gone through all the stages of grief with COVID. And so, you know, at first people maybe were in denial, and then, you know, they were angry, and then they were sad. And then, so I kind of feel like it's, you know, because it has definitely been a life-changing event for everyone. And so I think a lot of people are kind of at that acceptance stage at the moment with COVID. Okay, this is here to stay, and we may need to learn to live with it. So, you know, and some people are just tired of being in the COVID rut with their health and want to kind of take control over something because, you know, everyone was kind of forced to do stop maybe doing certain things that they enjoyed and do other things. And so, you know, more people are realizing that, you know, the best defense against the negative health of COVID is to be at a healthy weight and control your risk factors for chronic diseases and have a healthy body. So, you know, this is something I've talked about before, but I don't think this has been talked about enough just with what we're trying to tell people to do to help with the outcomes of COVID. But you can control your health. You can control, you know, those types of risk factors, which is shown to be helpful in more positive outcomes if you get COVID. So so that's something that we can't stress enough. So you know, some of the trends that are common related to COVID include getting back to exercise and focusing on moving more. We know that a lot of people moved less. Some people really thrived during COVID because they had more time. You know, some people actually maybe created some better habits and are trying to keep those, which is awesome. Also, managing stress and anxiety in ways other than eating, because during COVID, we saw trends of people having more, you know, snacking and stress eating, boredom eating, you know, those kinds of things. So, so people are kind of trying to figure out at least what we're seeing about managing their stress and anxiety in other healthier ways. Continuing to eat at home, I love that trend. People eat less fast food. A lot of times people, if you get out of the habit of that, it doesn't taste as good. And so you try to get, you know, those other other ways that you can eat at home and have that be easy. And then also, you know, we've been kind of in survival mode in general with COVID. I think people are trying to get out of that and go to the more of a thrive mode, which is optimal eating, exercise, and lifestyle to give yourself the best fighting chance at beating whatever the world throws at us. We don't know what is coming ever. And that's one lesson that we've definitely learned. And we do realize that COVID can be more complicated than this, but the reality is that we know that being healthier helps prevent people from having those negative COVID outcomes, and your health is something that you can control. And so here's to 2022 and achieving your best health.
Yay.
So, I love it. Yeah. So if you like today's topic, go ahead and like this episode and add a comment below. If you've been listening to Practical Nutrition for a while or are brand new to our channel, go ahead and leave us a 5-star review. We would love that. We're continuously trying to grow this platform and share all of the nutrition knowledge that we can. And those reviews can help us to do that and reach more people. So thanks for tuning in today's episode, and we'll see you next time.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye.